function okay and function Arun, is it clear? I am getting echo. So function 2 is available. Similarly, function 3. Like that, consider we have 10 functions. Okay. Now, if I declare a variable inside any function, consider inside function 1, I am declaring a variable int x. So, what is the lifetime of this variable int x? It is like a local variable because we declared it inside function 1. So its lifetime is we can access it only within that function 1 only, right? Once function 1 execution completes, that variable x gets deleted automatically. So same x, if I want to access in function 2, it is not possible. In that scenario, we should declare it as a global variable, okay? So if you declare a variable as local, okay, that cannot be accessed by other functions. Now, if you declare it as a global, what happens? It can be accessible by all the functions. Consider we have 10 functions in our program. Once if you declare x as a global, okay, all 10 functions can access x, right? Now, I have a requirement like I want to make this x available to few functions like function 1, function 2, function 3 and make it unavailable to remaining functions, that is from function 4 to function 10. Okay, is it possible here? See here, once if you declare it as a global, all functions can access it, right? So here my requirement is I want to make it available to few functions and make it unavailable to few of the functions. It is not possible using this, right? So this leads to data insecurity. Okay, got it? Now, how to make it the requirement whatever I have mentioned just now? So that we can achieve using Java programming language. Okay, now how to achieve it? Consider you have function 3 and function 4 also, and there is another variable int y. My requirement is like I want to make this x available to two functions, 1 and 2, and y available to 3 and 4. If I declare x and y as global, okay, all the functions can access it. But my requirement is not that one. I want to restrict the access of it. Then how is it possible? Okay, using classes concept, there is a concept called class. Using classes concepts in Java, we can achieve that. Then how to achieve it? What you can do is take variable x and the functions which uses x data, function 1 and function 2. Move the variables and the functions which uses that data into a single unit. And another remaining things, you can move it into another unit. Okay. So by doing that, you can restrict the access of it. That how to achieve it, we'll see. Using classes concept, first of all, see here, class is a keyword in Java. Okay, class name. Okay, class name. Class name can be anything. Okay, and you write a block. Okay, inside that you write int x. Okay, and its related functions which uses x data. Okay, you write here function 2. So function 1 and function 2 wants to use x data. That's why I moved x and function 1, function 2 into a block. Okay. And similarly, what you can do is y and function 3, function 4, you make it into another class. Class okay, another class name, okay. Int y function 3 function 4. Okay, if you write like this, x can be used by only function 1 and function 2, okay, and y can be used only by function 3 and function 4. Like this, using Java concept, okay, there is a concept called classes, okay, we can achieve that in Java, okay. See here, if you are in C, using C programming, okay, if you declare it as a global, that can be accessible by all the functions. But my interest is, I want to make some variable can be accessible to only few of the functions. Okay, in that scenario, how to achieve it? That is not possible in C. So, in Java, we have a concept called encapsulation. Okay, what is that? Encapsulation. Using encapsulation, we can achieve that. What is encapsulation? The process of binding data. Data means variables. Okay, binding variables and related functions which uses that data into a single unit, okay, is called encapsulation. How are we achieving encapsulation? Using classes concepts in Java. Okay, guys, any doubt in this? See here. Binding of data are variables. Variables and functions into a single unit is called encapsulation. Okay. So what are we doing is x and the functions which uses x, we are making it one unit. Okay. This concept we call it as encapsulation. How are we achieving encapsulation? Using classes concept. Okay. Using class, we are achieving encapsulation. Guys, any doubt in this? Hello? Is it clear how to write a class? Class, space, and class name, okay, and open curly brace and closing curly brace. Inside that, you write some variables and functions, okay, functions which uses x data, okay. Similarly, you can write another class, okay, like that you can write n number of classes, okay. This is the syntax how to write a class. Okay, when you write a class, there will not be any memory allocation, okay, for the class. Then, how to allocate memory for a class? Something called object is there. There is a concept called object. Okay, so what is object? Object is nothing but allocation of memory to class. Okay, allocation of memory to class members. Okay, got it? How to create object, we'll see. Okay, so any doubt in this, how to write a class? Class is a keyword and space and class name, that can be anything. Okay, open curly brace, and then if you want to write any variables, write variables and functions which uses that variables and closing curly brace. For example, class arithmetic. Okay, so this is class arithmetic. Okay, inside that, what I am doing is int x equal to 10, comma int y equal to 20. Okay, now I am writing two functions void add. Okay, inside that, how to do addition, we'll write soon. Similarly, why it's subtraction. Okay? So, like this, we can write a class. Excuse me, guys. I will be back in now. So, any doubt in this, how to write a class? In Java, everything is like a class, okay? So, inside class, what will be there? Some variables and some functions, right? So, void is one function, void add, add is one function, sub is one function. Okay, x and y are variables. Okay, so inside class, what we can write? Variables and functions. Okay, so in Java terminology, functions we call it as methods. No difference between function and method, only terminology. In Java, we will call it as methods. Okay, so add is one method, similarly, sub also method. Okay. So, variables holds data. So, we can call these variables as data also. Okay. Now, the process of binding data and its related methods into a single unit is called encapsulation. Okay. How are we achieving that binding of data and methods into a single unit? Using classes concept. Okay. Class is a keyword. And then give some space and then write any class name. It can be anything inside that. Okay, inside that class block, you can declare variables and then write some methods which uses the data. Okay, guys, any doubt in that? Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay, so what class contains? Class contains variables and methods. Inside this code, we'll see later how to write add method code and sub method code. Okay. Now, so these variables and methods altogether we call it. Okay. So, what class contains? Class contains variables and methods. Inside this code, we'll see later how to write add method code and sub method code. Okay, now, so these variables and methods altogether we call it as members of the class. Okay, so whatever is there inside a class, we call all those are members. Now, this class has both data and methods, so it has four members. X is one member, Y is another member, add is another member, sub is another member. Okay, so arithmetic class has four members, X, Y, add and sub. Okay, what are the members of the class? Variables and methods. Okay, now, so variables and members, okay, are the members. What are the members of the class? Variables and methods. Okay, methods are nothing but functions only. Okay, so in Java terminology we will call it as method. That's why I am replacing it as method, okay, instead of functions. Okay, now once consider in Java how it will be everything is like a class. Then in C programming we know, see here I have functions, function 1, function 2, function 3, and function 4. Like that I have. Hello? See here, I have 4 functions. If I want to call these functions, okay, how to call function? So consider we have a method. Sorry, we have a function main in C programming. Okay, how to call function 1? Just use the function name and then parenthesis. In case if it is taking any arguments,
pass the arguments. Okay, this is how we will call a function in C programming language, right? So whenever you call function one using this statement, automatically in main, whenever main start execution, okay, function one gets executed, okay, and its corresponding output we can see. Similarly, if you want to call function two, okay, so this is how we'll call in C programming language. But in case of Java, we cannot call directly, okay. That means, like how we will call function one, function two, similarly I cannot call add like that, add sum, okay, like that we cannot call, okay. Here all are available inside a class, okay. First of all, if you want to access or if you want to call any method, okay, first we should know where that method is available. All methods are available inside class, right? That can be any class. See here, sub method, add method, where is it available? It is available in some class called arithmetic. Like that, whatever the code you will write, that will be available in some of the classes, right? So first of all, if you are interested to call or access any particular method, first of all, you should know where that method is exactly available. That means in which class it is available. For that class, as I said some time back, for class, there won't be any memory allocation. When you create an object for that class, then only memory will be allocated, okay, for that class. So if you want to access or if you want to call any method, first you need to find where is it available. That means in which class it is available. For example, my interest is I want to call add method. So first I have to know where is it available. Okay, it is available in arithmetic class. So first I should create object for that class. Then using that object, we should access this add method. Now the question is how to create object. For example, somehow I came to know that, okay, I want to use add method. That add method is available in a class arithmetic. Once if I know the class name, how to create object for that class, okay? Now, creating object, object for class, okay? See here, let me write the syntax. Class name, okay, and object name also it can be anything like a variable name only, you can give any name, okay, and new operator actually allocates memory, okay, so new and then again class name and then parenthesis semicolon. This is the statement to create object for any class, okay. How to create object? This is the statement. For example, now if I want to create an object for class A, okay, how to create, sorry, class arithmetic, okay. So first of all, class name means arithmetic class, okay. So for arithmetic class, hello guys, can you please go on mute? Okay, now I want to call add method, okay? If I want to call add method, first I should create an object for the class where add method is available. So add method is available in arithmetic class. So I am creating an object for arithmetic class. How to create an object? This is the syntax to create an object, okay? So class name, arithmetic. Object name, it can be anything, consider O1 or anything it can be, okay, and new, okay, and then again class name, and then give parenthesis and semicolon. This is how we'll create object, okay. So this is object. What is the object name? O1. Once if you create object, how to access members of that class using object, okay. Syntax is object name dot member name, object name dot member name. Okay, that member can be anything, add function or anything, it can be a variable or anything. Okay, so this is how we'll access members of a class. Okay, so example o1 dot add, this is how we'll access a method, or this is how we call or invoke a method which is available in Sidious inside some class. Okay, got it guys? Any doubt in this? So you understood how to write a class. Class gives some space and then class name. Okay, open curly brace, closing curly brace. Inside that you declare variables and write some of the methods. Okay, that is syntax of declaring variables, writing methods, everything is same as C programming only, no difference in that. Only difference is how to write a class. Okay, now from this example, I think you understood how to write a class. Once if you write a class, if somebody wants to access the members of this class, they must create object for this class. Okay, so we should know how to create an object for class. This is the syntax and example. Once if you create an object, how to access the members of that class using object. If I want to use some class X, for that class X, first I should create an object using object only, object name dot, then members of that class I can access it. Okay, that is what I am showing here. Okay, whatever I highlighted in this blue color, this is how we'll access or invoke members of any class. Okay, got it? Any doubt in this?
No. So same way we can add the variables as well, right?
Yes.
So because you said members, yeah. So 0, 1, dot, variable.
Okay, members can be either variable or method. You can access any member. Okay.
Okay.
No difference in that. Okay.
No problem.
Yeah, guys. Did you guys install Eclipse? If it is already installed in your systems, please open it once. Let me show you. Once if you open Eclipse, this is how it looks like. Shall I start from beginning? Let me open once. Once if you install Java and Eclipse, okay, you will get an icon like a shortcut like this, okay, Eclipse. Just double click on it, it will open. When it is launching, it will ask you to select the workspace. Now, what is workspace? Okay, it is asking select a directory as workspace. So, see here, whatever we'll write programs, that should be saved somewhere in our system, right? It is asking you to select that folder or directory where you want to save your programs, okay? So on my desktop, okay, I created a folder called Java Programs, okay? I am selecting it, okay? That means in that Java Programs, all the programs, whatever I am going to write it now, it will save, okay? Or else, let me create another one, okay? See here, now it will create Java program. Now, whatever the programs I am going to write from now, it will be saved inside this folder. Workspace is where you want to save the programs. See here, let it open. By then we'll cover something. In C programming, you have a C program. Consider you have four functions, function 1, function 2, function 3. You save that with a.c or example.c. If you run it, if you want to run it, you must need main method, right? We must need main method. Without main, whatever you will write inside that file, no use, right? So always entry point is main method. So your file must contain a entry point, that is main method. Once main method is available, your C or Java, in case of Java JVM, okay, Java will execute that main method. Whatever you are invoking or calling inside method, only those things will be executed. Consider I have four functions in my C program. Inside my main, if I call only function 1 and function 2, what happens? It will execute only function 1 and function 2, right? Though 3 and 4 are available, no use. In case, if function 1 and function 2 are indirectly calling function 3 and 4, then it gets executed. Otherwise, it will not execute 3 and 4, okay? So, whatever you want to do the operation, that all the things you must write inside main method, okay? Then always your program execution starts from main method or main function, then whatever is there inside main, that gets executed, okay? Similarly, in case of Java also, okay, in case of Java also, see here, you have a class like this, class arithmetic, two variables, add sub, okay? Now, add sub are available, okay? In addition to that, we must need a main method. We must need a main method. Main method is a entry point. From there only program execution starts. From there only program execution starts. Now, let me write a main method. Public static void main, okay? And string s, and main method means it should be having braces, okay, curly braces. Inside that you write either you call add or sub, whatever you want to do, you do, okay? Now, is it correct way? No, we must to access or to call add method or sub method, as I said sometime back, first you should create an object to access, right? So directly we cannot access members of any class. First we should create an object for that, okay? So arithmetic, I am creating object, arithmetic, object name A1, it can be anything, and new arithmetic, okay? And then object is available. Once object is available, using object, you just use object name dot and member name A1 dot sub. Okay, like this we can call. So, like C programming, in Java also, we must need a main method. Okay, now you may get question like, why this main looks like this? Public static, generally if you see in C programming, okay, void main is the main method, okay? Here main method notation is like this, public static void main. That main also should take a string array, okay, string array as an argument. This is how if you write a main method, then your Java will understand like, okay, this program has a main method so that I can go and execute. Otherwise, it will not understand. It won't consider like main method available. Consider if you write a main method like this, it will not understand. Okay, the Java standard main method notation is this. Later, after one or two classes, I will explain what is the meaning of this public, static, and why string arguments, each and every line of this, each and every token of this line, okay? For time being, you consider like, this is how we should write a main method in Java, okay? Got it? So once, if you write main method, inside that, how to write statements, you know, right? Create object, and using object, you call members of that class, okay? Got it, guys? Now, Eclipse. When you launch Eclipse, if any doubts, please ask me, okay? So when you launch Eclipse, it looks like this. Here right side, you have option called Workbench. Just click on Workbench. Okay, you will get Java perspective. Here, file, okay, project. You should create a project, inside project. Okay, some we will write classes. Before writing a new, before creating a new project, I want to show you a simple one, how it looks like overall project structure. See here, guys. If you see here, generally, where are we writing all variables and methods? Inside class, right? So inside class, we will be having methods, right? So class, like this, in our project, if you consider any project, we will be having hundreds of classes, okay? All these classes, what we will do is, we will group into different categories. For example, consider networking related, some classes are there in your project, something related to storage, something related to some X operation, something related to some functionality. We will categorize all those into one category. We will divide those into one different categories, okay? And we will keep all these inside a folder, okay? In Java terminology, we call it as like package. We will see later what is package and all. Consider you have 1,000 classes in your project. So for maintainability purpose, to make the maintainability easy, what we will do, we will categorize those into different categories, okay? So one category related, all will keep in one folder, another category related, we will keep in another folder like that. That folder, we call it as a package in Java terminology, okay? So related classes, we will write inside one folder, okay? Or inside a package, okay? Package and folder both are same. Like that, multiple packages, we call it as a project, okay? See here. This is how it looks. Is it visible, clear? See guys, project, okay? So Java basics like that, you give any name to your project. That big one is project. We'll start from small one, inner one. Basic things are classes. Inside class, you will be having methods and variables. Like that, multiple classes you will be having. Multiple related classes will group into one package. Okay, like that, multiple packages we will be having inside a project. This is how it looks. Project, inside project, you will be having packages. Okay, inside package, you will be having multiple classes. Inside class, you will be having variables and methods, as I shown here. Okay, inside class, you will be having variables and methods. Okay, this is how it looks. Now, I am going to create a project. First, we need to create a project, okay? After that, we'll write classes inside the package, okay? Inside the package. All these classes, we call it as SRC, source code, okay? Got it? Now, let me create a project. To create new project in Eclipse, just here, left side, top corner, you see there is an option called File. If you click on New, you will get Java Project option. Okay, just click on it. And this is, you can give any name. Okay, for example, this is Java Programming. Is the project considered. Okay, Java Programming. Okay, just click on Finish. After that, left side, you will get that project. Okay, Java Programming, this is the project. Like that, you can create another one. Okay, New and create another project, anything, test, like that, whatever it might be. Okay, like this, you can create n number of projects. Okay, once if you create project, just click on that arrow mark, expand it. inside that SRC. SRC is not showing currently any down arrow, okay? Actually, right till now, we did not write any program in this, right? Once if you write, then it will show you on this SRC, okay? So what you have to do? Create a package, okay? So create new package, okay? Got it? Select on SRC and then right click on it, new, and then package. So this is basic examples. Okay, just finish it so that it created another one. Okay, package is like a folder. So inside that package, you can write a class called arithmetic. See here, class, okay, new class. Inside package, just right click on package and new and then class. Okay, now I want to write arithmetic class. Just class name you give, okay, automatically Eclipse, what it will do is, it will create a class template and it will give you. See, just now we mentioned, see here, it is showing class and arithmetic. Whatever the name we gave for class name, with that it created one class. Inside class, whatever you want, you write variables, okay, and methods. Got it? Here we'll write how to write variables and methods inside a class. Okay, see guys, here before class, something called public is there. What is that public? We will see in next 2-3 classes. For time being, you ignore that public. Okay, got it? Now, I want to do addition operation. Okay, first what I have to do, int x equal to 10. Okay, and int y equal to 20. Two variables I declared, and void add addition I want to do, okay, addition. And just what, before going to addition, let me show something called how to print statement something, okay? So system dot out dot println is the statement which we use for printing some data on console, okay? System.out.println is equal to printf statement in C programming. Actually, only println is equal to printf. Then what is the use of this system.out that I will explain in next 2-3 classes. Now maybe, now if I explain also, we may not understand it, okay? Guys, is it clear? See here, inside that, whatever you will write in double quotes, it will be printed as it is, okay? So addition is, okay? So it will print that addition value, okay? Is, okay? And then for that string, if you want to add or concatenate some values, variable values, okay, or some data, what you can do is use simple like a expression. See guys, x and y I am adding, and that result I am adding to this string. This whatever is println, whatever is there in double quote, that will be printed as it is, okay? So what we will expect output, addition value is, and one space after that, x plus y value, it should continue, it should show, okay? Now, we have a addition, okay? And see here, I have a add method. Now, if I want to run this program, how to run it? Right click on this program and then run as. See here, when you do run as, here generally we should get run as instead of run configurations. In addition to this, we should get one more option called Java application. Okay, when you will get that is when we will get that option. If your class is having a main method, then JVM will understand, okay, this class has a main method, so that there is a entry point so that I can go and execute main method. It will understand and then it will show that option run as Java application. Okay, run as is currently not showing Java application option. Why? Because there is no main method. Once if you add main method, then only it will show. Okay, let me write main method, public static void main. Okay, this is the main method. Later I will explain what is the meaning of each token in this line. Okay, for now just consider this full thing is like a main method, how to write main in Java. Okay, now once main is available, you check here, run as. Now it is showing Java application. Okay, now just run it, run as Java application. This source file has been modified, you want to save it? Yes. Okay, now we executed. So did we write any statements inside main? No, we did not write any statements inside main. So what JVM will do? JVM is a software piece inside JDK. Whatever you installed JDK, right, to get Java, inside that one piece of software JVM is available, Java Virtual Machine, that is responsible for actually execution. Okay, now it started executing main method because it found main method also, but inside that main we did not write any statement, that's why it did not execute anything. Okay, now write one print statement, welcome. Okay, now what happens when we run this program? Right click that program, run as Java application, then you will get output like welcome. See here guys, in below there is an option called console. Okay, inside console you can see the output welcome. Though addition program is addition method is available, I am not accessing addition method. Why? I did not call it inside main. Okay, if you don't call it inside main, it never executes. Okay, whatever is written inside main, only that gets executed. Remaining things, though it is available, no use of it. Okay, see here only one printf statement we wrote inside main method, so it executed that printf and it printed the output. Okay, now my intention is I want to call this add addition. Okay, once if I consider I wrote many methods like add, sub, multiplication, all those to perform different operations, but if I don't call them or if I don't use them, no use of that methods, right? Then question is how to call them. Okay, if you want to access them or call them, you should call them inside the main, then only it gets executed, otherwise it won't execute, right? So I want to call addition method here. Addition method here. Now this is the style of calling method in C programming, but in case of Java it is bit different. First we need to create object for the class where this method is available. Okay, this addition method is available inside a class called arithmetic, so first I should create an object for that arithmetic. A1 equal to new arithmetic. Okay, see here, now I wrote a class, I created a class, inside that I have a method addition also. Okay, now my intention is I want to call addition method inside main, so I wrote a main method also. Inside main earlier what we did is just we wrote a statement of printing. Okay, see right click and then run as Java application. started printing this. Okay, but though addition is available inside class, we are not calling it from main method. That is the reason it did not execute addition method. Now, how to call addition method? So in Java, if you want to call or invoke any method, first step is you should create an object, because to access members we must make object name dot member name we should use. Okay, so first we should create an object for the class, and then using the object you access members of that class. Okay, now see here, I am creating. That and printed welcome as well. Okay. Now, see here, inside this class, if you write another method, hide display. Okay. So inside display, just write a print statement. Okay. This is from display method. Just I want to see this message, just printing some message. Okay, now how to call that method? Using object a1 dot. Okay, a1 dot object is already available. One time if you create object, that is enough. Okay, once if you have object, that object you can use n number of time to use, to access or to call members of that class. Okay, so display a1 dot display. Okay, now like this you can create an object, and then you access members of the class using object. Okay, is it clear guys? Any doubt in this? Now let me explain one more thing here. Whatever I mentioned just now, this is object creation statement, right? This is object creation statement. But actually here, sometime back I mentioned object name dot member name. Object name dot member name. Okay? But this is not actually an object. A1 is not an object. Okay? See here, let me explain you. Whenever you write the statement arithmetic a equal to a1, okay, arithmetic a1 equal to new arithmetic, what is the meaning of this statement is actually this right side portion of the equal, that means new arithmetic, this is only creating object. What is object? Object is allocation of memory per class. Okay, object is memory allocation per class. Okay, who will do that job? Actually this new and this statement, whatever I highlighted in the full statement, the portion which is available right side of the equal to is actually responsible for creating object. That means actually creating object means allocation of memory, right? So this new arithmetic only will allocate memory for arithmetic class. New will be used for allocating memory. For which class? For arithmetic. So this is right side of portion of equal to is actual part of creating object. Then what is left side one? Once if you create an object, for example, let me show here. Whenever it executes, it will allocate memory inside the RAM. like this. Okay, it will allocate memory. Okay, it will allocate memory. So what are the members? A, X, Y, add, okay, X, comma, Y, X, and some memory is allocated for X, and similarly for Y some memory, and okay, like that for all the members. For example, you have add, for add also it will do some addition or something, okay? So for all the class members, it will allocate memory. When you create object using the statement this, okay? Just you write only this portion. See here, whatever I am showing here, see, let me write in Eclipse only. Instead of writing this full statement, just if you write only this right side portion, new arithmetic, that only will create the object. That only will create the object. Object in the sense, memory allocation. It will only do this job. Okay, once if it does that, okay, to access this, so see here, what this new will do is, new arithmetic, it will allocate memory like this, and it will be having some address, right, in memory location, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is the address location. This address location, it will return, okay? Once if it returns that address location, that is up to you if you want to save it or don't save it. Okay, if you want to save, you create a variable of that class and then assign that. Okay. In programming, if you declare a variable as local, you have an idea about C programming, right? Hello? Can you hear me? Yeah, I have an idea about C programming. Please go on. Okay, Java, any idea? I, to some extent, yeah. Okay, then fine, no need to cover this. Just, this is what we are trying is, just we wrote a class, okay? Okay, inside that class we have two variables and we declared a method also.
Okay.
We have to run that method, always program execution starts from main method, right?
Perfect, so, yeah. I understand this, don't worry.
We got a main method and then we are trying to create object. Using object, we are accessing those addition and display. Okay,
okay. That's perfect. Okay, perfect. Thank you. This is enough. Don't worry.
Are you able to see?
Yeah.
Actually, this new arithmetic is actually responsible for creating object. Okay. In line number 21, this is how we'll create object. Sometime back, I mentioned the syntax of creating object, but actually, line number 20 is enough to create object. What is object? Object is nothing but memory allocation for class. Right. So this is how it will allocate memory inside RAM. Okay. For which class it will be decided here. Okay. Arithmetic class. So new operator will allocate memory for members of arithmetic class. Once if it allocate memory, it will return the address. This is the address consider. Okay. It will return the address of that object. Once if it returns, that is up to you whether you want to save it or not to save. Okay, in line number 20, we are not saving it. Just we are creating object. In line number 21, we are storing the address or reference of that object. Okay, so this right side portion, whatever it creates object, okay, that object's reference it returns, that we are storing into a variable. Now in line number 21, let me explain one more point. Int is a primitive data type, like that we have float, double, right? All these are predefined data types. So whatever the class names you are writing, see here, what is the class name here? Arithmetic, right? Arithmetic is one class name. Like that, if you write tomorrow some other class, hello, whatever it might be the class name, all the class names will act like, one second guys, okay? So here all class types, arithmetic or everything, acts like a data type, like how integer is one data type, okay, float is one data type. Similarly, your class names also acts like data type. Okay, so I am whatever the object you will create, for which class you are creating object, this right side portion, it is creating object for arithmetic class. Its reference variable you should assign to arithmetic type variable. So I am creating a variable a1 of type arithmetic. All class names acts like data types. So I am creating a variable a1, okay, a reference variable a1 of type arithmetic to point to object of arithmetic class. Okay, this right side portion, new arithmetic, actually creates object and it returns the reference of it. That reference variable I am storing in a1. Okay, now actually a1 is not a object, it is a reference variable to the object. Okay, got it? Now what is the need of saving it? Just if you do like this also, control x, let me do this. See, to create reference, I got it, right? Addition. Similarly, I can do here this A1 also, I can replace it. Okay, so whenever objects you need to create every time, unnecessarily you are creating so many objects, okay, unnecessarily you are wasting the memory. Okay, so instead of that one, what you can do, one time you create and store that object reference. In this one you are not storing, just that reference in that line you will
Hello?
Is it?
Yes, your voice kept getting cut. So, can you please repeat?
Yeah, sure. Okay, okay, no problem. See here, this is how generally we create object and calling the methods, right? Using object name. But actually, what is object? This new arithmetic, okay? Whatever is there right side of this equal to, this is actually responsible for creating object. What there is object?
Share your screen.
Yes, sorry.
anyone is facing issue, right? Immediately they saw that it will not mess up. You know, will not skip too much.
I thought like it's going fine.
Nobody is telling, right? So... yeah, share the screen.
Are you able to see the screen now?
Yeah.
Actually, this line number 21, arithmetic A1 new arithmetic. This is how we'll create object, right? But only this right portion of equal to is really responsible for creating object like this. Okay, let me... Only this portion, whatever here I am highlighting in rectangle, right? Only this portion, that right side of that equal to will do. It will allocate memory and then it will return the address of that object or the reference of that object, okay? Then, once if you are returning reference of that, see here, if any method is returning a integer value, what we will do in C programming and all, if any function is returning integer, when we call that method, it will return integer, consider. What we will do, we will assign the value, whatever it returns, to a integer type variable. Similarly, this new arithmetic, it will allocate memory and it will return the address or reference of that object. Okay, it will allocate memory for the class and it will return the address of that memory allocation that we want to store it in a variable. Reason is, instead of writing this a1.addition everywhere instead of a1, what I can do is I can just replace this object creation. Okay, if I do like this, what happens every time it will create object? This is, see here, line number 23, new arithmetic, it will create object, it will return the reference of that object. That object contains my addition like this so that I can access it, right? So it will create object and it will return the reference. Using reference, I'm accessing addition. Similarly, again, new arithmetic, one more object it creates. Using that, it will return the reference. Using that reference, I am calling display. Like that, if I have 100 methods, if I want to access all those, what happens? If I follow this current structure of just using new everywhere, it will create objects like this unnecessarily. Multiple objects for the same class. Actually, one is enough for us. Okay, if you are using this style of programming, so many objects it creates, so that memory unnecessarily we are wasting it. To avoid that one, what we will do, whenever this new arithmetic is returning reference of that object, is it object of which type? Arithmetic type. So you create a variable of arithmetic type. That means in Java programming, right? In Java, like integer, float, how those are predefined data types. Similarly, your class names also acts like a data type, okay? So arithmetic also acts like a data type. This is a object of arithmetic. So it will return the object of arithmetic, reference of arithmetic object. So that reference I should store in arithmetic type variable A1. Okay, like int A1, arithmetic A1. So arithmetic acts like a data type. Consider, see here, in case of pointers, C programming pointers, if you want to hold the address of integer pointer, you need a pointer variable of type integer only, right? Similarly, if you want to store the reference of arithmetic type object, you need a reference variable or a variable of type arithmetic only. Okay, now using A1, if I do like this, then what happens? Same object only I am going to use everywhere instead of creating it multiple times. Okay, same object, instead of using these many objects, what we are doing, that we are assigning to a reference variable A1. Okay, A1 dot means automatically A1 contains reference of that object, that we can access same object multiple times and we can access members of that class. Okay, got it guys? Did you understand this line number 21, what is it exactly? Arithmetic A1 equal to new arithmetic?
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Is it clear?
Yes. Since I have some idea about this, so it's clear for me.
Yeah. What about Savitri and Gopi? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, Gopi, is it clear? Line number 21. Savitri, are you there on call?
Venkat, can you hear me?
Yeah. Did you understand this? Line number 21?
Yes, I'm good, Venkat. I will ask if I have any doubts. Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
So I can proceed it. Okay?
Fine. Yeah.
Thank you. So, always what we will do is, first we should create an object for a class. For example, our requirement is we want to use a method. That method might be available in some class X. First, if you want to access that method, first you must create an object for that class. Using object, okay, you can access. Till now I am telling this statement, but we are going to correct it. Using the reference of that object we are going to access. Okay, this A1 is called as reference, not exactly object. This right side portion only creates object. Its address is stored in A1, so A1 indirectly pointing to same object which is created in this right side portion. Okay, so here A1 is actually not an object, a reference which points to the object. Okay, so always if you want to access members of any class, you must need a reference variable of that class, okay, which points to object. And then use dot operation. Once if you use reference variable dot, then it will show, okay, all the members of that class. See here, how many members are there inside this class? X, Y, and addition, and then display, okay? Now, though main method is a member of that class, it will not show, okay? See here, A1 dot, okay, A1 dot, so X is from arithmetic class. See here, X is a integer type. Using A1, what and all you can access? You can access X, Y, addition, display. Okay, all these four are members of arithmetic class. In addition to these four, it is showing so many things, clone, okay, and then equals, finalize, get class, hash code, all these. These are from different class. Then why is it showing this? We will see when we enter into inheritance. Okay, for now, just you can see here, once if you have a reference variable of some class, using that you can access all the members of that class. Okay, X, Y, display, and addition. Four are the members. Okay, in this class, four members we have, we can access those. Okay, got it?
Venkat, can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So when you say that arithmetic A1, you're defining the, you'll get the reference physical address, right?
Yeah.
Of the class, which the class contains variables and it contains functions. So yeah. I'm trying to understand, it will return the memory location.
Correct.
Which will be, will it be a range or will it be just one cell number?
One number.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
that number is not directly address of that memory location. It is like encrypted one. We call it as a hash code. Okay.
Okay.
It is not direct memory location of that. Okay.
So for a memory location of a class is always a hash code, which is encrypted. So it is not a specific number you're trying to say.
This A1, whatever A1 is.
Yes.
We will understand. I will explain that. It is having some format. Okay.
Okay.
Consider it is having some reference of object, arithmetic class object, right?
Okay.
So let me run it. I will explain. It is having the format of class name @ and then some number. See here, it is showing class name. Okay. This is the reference. Okay. See, class name, full class name, fully qualified class name. This arithmetic is the class name available in a package, basic examples. Okay. So class name, okay, fully qualified class name, @ and hash code. Okay.
Okay. So this, if you, sorry.
Go ahead.
Okay, thanks. If you do not include this line saying package basic examples, will you get an error or will the output be different, look different?
Which line? Line number
yes.
One, you are telling?
Yes.
No, even actually Eclipse will throw here error. If you are writing in Notepad or anywhere, this output will be same. No change in that. Okay, at that time, just... if you mention, right, it will show that full, otherwise it will show only arithmetic, okay, where that class is.
Okay. So the purpose of that basic examples is?
Just in which package this class is available, okay. Actually, this is how the full structure of that, let me show you. Generally, we write classes, right? So related classes will group into one folder that we call it as in Java terminology, multiple related classes will group together and will form a package, networking package, some storage package, like that depends upon your class will project will be having 1,000 classes related to different functionality. One functionality related, you group into one folder or group into one package, we call it as folder is nothing but package only. Okay. Multiple packages, we call it as overall project. Okay. So inside this also, second package also, you will be having some related classes. Okay.
But the first line that is actually, it's calling a pre-existing package, right? Provided by Eclipse. I mean the JDK. Basic examples.
Okay. Who will provide this? Yeah, actually, whenever you create a new class inside this, see here, just we created a.
Oh project, my bad. Inside so this that, is something you created, right? Okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah, if you don't create any package, automatically it will show default package. Whose name is default package.
Okay. Fine.
So we created a project, inside that we created package, inside package I created a class.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Venkat, I have one question.
Yeah.
So why do we worry about this memory thing? Because it's the enhance the performance of the execution?
Correct, right? Okay. See, if it is full, we have some RAM size, consider 4 GB. So many objects are there inside that. Our system performance automatically comes down, right?
Yeah.
if you use effectively, then performance will be more.
For okay.
Okay. Actually, we have something called garbage collector in Java. Okay? We need not to call it explicitly. Automatically, JVM is a piece of software inside Java JDK.
Okay.
It will automatically invokes that program, garbage collector. What it will do, unreferenced objects and all, automatically it will delete.
Okay.
Own algorithms, no need to worry about that. It will take care. Even though unnecessarily we are using more means, at least consider garbage collector program will be invoked by JVM for every 5 minutes.
Okay.
It's that 5 minutes, if you have so many, we'll get that problem, right?
That's okay.
And Venkat, one more question. So will you be discussing about dynamic memory allocation and all that? Because for this particular object, right now you have two integer variables defined. So to get an idea about how much memory is being consumed by this object?
Yeah, that if you want, I will explain tomorrow, but that is not required for our testing purpose. Actually, in Java, in C programming, what happens is whenever you create a variable in X, immediately memory will be allocated for X. Into Y, memory will be allocated. But in case of Java, it will, you have a class considered like this. It will not allocate memory.
Okay.
Okay. Inside memory or anywhere, whenever you create object, then only it will allocate memory.
Okay.
That means that, so when program execution starts, then only these things will execute.
For so line number 24, it'll allocate memory, right? For the variables?
Line number 21.
Oh, for 21 itself, okay.
Yeah, correct. That new operator.
So
this is only dynamic memory allocation. So, for class members, there won't be any memory allocation. Class is just like a template.
There won't be
any memory allocation. Whenever you create object, at that time, dynamically, it will allocate memory.
Okay. One question. For line 21, when it allocates memory, how much memory does it allocate? How will it know what the user is going to use the object for? Based on that,
how much memory means, see here, like in C programming, in Java also, we have in C, if it is a character variable, one byte, right?
Yes,
if it is integer 2. Here also, we will be having for character 2 bytes, for integer, I think 2 or 4. Like that, it will be having fixed one, And how many variables, data members you have, those ones. That much amount of memory it will allocate whenever this statement executes.
Okay. So it doesn't allocate anything for the function, the addition display?
Actually, there won't be any memory allocation for functions.
Okay.
But there will be some reference internally to access those. But memory won't be there. Okay.
Now,
another thing, let me explain. Tomorrow I will cover that. You have some variable int p here. Inside a function. Now, for this P, there won't be memory allocation inside object. For P, it will not allocate memory inside. So for this comes under a category called local variable that we will see, we will discuss tomorrow. At that time, it will allocate in a different place of RAM.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other doubts, guys? See here, generally if you take any project and all, how it looks, one entry point will be there. Okay, consider this main is not there. Okay, consider that main method is not there. Like this, you will be having arithmetic related classes, some extra classes, X, Y, Z classes. Okay, so to start the program execution, that main one, main should be there. Okay. See here, without main, how many classes and methods you will write, no use, because JVM will not execute, because there is no start point to start your program execution. So we need a main method. Okay, like this, consider arithmetic and XYZ classes. You have some methods inside that. Okay, now you are going to start a entry point one, like a class, entry point or anything. Name can be anything. Inside that, see here, sometime back when I wrote class, see here, just if you give class name, we will get a class template. Inside that, variables and methods you only declare. Okay, so main method I can write here also. Okay, so I cannot run arithmetic class because arithmetic class doesn't have main method, so it will not show run as Java application. But this entry point class has a main method. If you run this, what happens? It will use that class, okay, and it will invoke that, see here, okay? So it will start executing this main method. Here intention is using addition and display methods of arithmetic class. So if I want to use those methods, first I should create an object because I need a reference variable of that class. So I created it, okay? And then I'm accessing those two methods, or I'm calling those two methods. Now here reference variable, without creating object, just you declare a reference variable, just like this, okay? At the time, this A1 is not holding any address. That is the reason it is showing error. You cannot access. So always you need a reference variable which holds the reference of an object. So this is a reference variable, holds the reference or address of an object, okay? That kind of reference variable only you should require to access members of any class. Got it? So any doubt? So main method, you need not to write in all the classes. Write in any one of the class, okay? That is like entry point. From there, you try to access other class methods based on your requirement, okay? Guys, is it clear? Now, let me explain one more thing. Here, whenever we are writing new class, okay? Just now I wrote a new class. Let me create another one. This is like test, just I want to show something. See here, just template only, it will show class template. If I want a main method also inside that, by default automatically, if I want to main method also, what you can do is, see here, while creating new class, there is a checkbox. Okay, public static void main, give me that also in that template. Just check, okay? Check box is there. You check it and then, okay, give that test one, okay, class name, and you select this checkbox, then automatically you will get main method also. See here, earlier it was giving only class. Inside class it was not providing any methods, but this time it provided a main method also, okay? You need not to write, automatically it will give. Okay, this is how we'll create a new project. Inside that we can create new package. Inside that we can write new classes. Once if you write a new class like this, okay, inside that you can write what are the members of the class, variables and methods. You have some variables and methods. Okay, now if anyone wants to access, or if you want to access, okay, in the same class or different class, if you want to access members of any class, first you must need an object of it, not exactly object. Object is required. What we need is exactly a reference variable pointing to that object. Using that reference variable, you can access it. Okay, access the members of that class. Now let me reframe this sentence. Okay, how to create object? Create object is this one, absolutely fine. Is it object name? No, it is a reference name. Okay, or a reference variable name points to object. Got it? Using that only you should access it. Okay, a reference variable name pointing to object. Okay, so got it?
Yeah, Venkat, I have one question, Venkat. Can you go to the Eclipse screen?
Yeah, oh, 1 minute. Is it clear? This notepad here, how to create object? Okay, actually A1 is not a object. Okay, yeah.
So, so we give, you give the object reference number A1.addition, right? And A1.display. Yeah. But where, how come it is coming automatically? So add addition is like, it is already a predefined function in it.
Which one?
The answer is coming like addition value, right? Value is 30. So we don't need to give any formula, it is automatically.
Okay. Actually, see here, what addition, okay, we are calling from arithmetic class, right? Because A1 is a reference of arithmetic class. Okay, just click on control and control on that, you will get mouse pointer like this. Just click on it, control click on arithmetic, it will take you to arithmetic class. Actually here arithmetic class contains addition method. This method it is invoking from that class. Okay,
so we already given the arithmetic class, right?
Okay. Yeah, in arithmetic class already we have a method addition. It is taking these two variables and adding and then printing. This addition only we are trying to call inside this here. Okay. Got it?
Okay. I understand.
Now, whatever the methods you want to call, that need not to be present inside your own class. It can be anywhere, but the thing is you need object. First, you need to create an object for that, and using object, you can access them. Okay?
Now, yeah. So you said like I can, it can calling from anywhere, right? So here just one class, we know that arithmetic class is invoking this one. So how should we, in real time, how should we able to know that which class it is coming from?
Okay. For example, your requirement is like you want to create a random number generator. Okay. For example, your requirement is, for our requirement, everything is implemented inside one method. They might have placed this method in some other class. Okay. Now, my requirement, I want to generate a random number. Okay. Okay. Just here, random number generator in Java. Okay. Predefined, or else alphanumeric. See here, random number method in Java. So here we may get some help. Like see, in Java, there is a method random. Okay, there is a method random available. From this, what did you understand? Okay, I should use a method called random. For example, here only, I am going to use that, okay? Random, okay, I want to use random. Now, where is that available? That random is a method. All methods are available in some classes, right?
Yeah.
Is it clear? So, to access random, first I should know where is it available, in which class it is available. Okay, they mentioned there is a class called math. There is a class called math. Okay?
Okay,
so I should create object of math, m1 equal to new math, okay? Math m1 dot random, okay? Got it?
Sure.
So, like that, we should know first where that method is available. Math M1 equal to new math. Okay. Now I created a object like this. Okay. Now see here, it is showing an error because math class doesn't have a constructor like this. What is constructor? You will understand tomorrow. Okay. I will explain later. So this is how we should create, and then m1.random. Okay. Like this we should call. Okay. But they are not allowing us to create an object for math. There are some reasons that I will explain later. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So like that in real-time programs also, we will be able to know like which function it is invoking. Which
method you want to use. For example, if our goal is to try to automate some test cases. Okay.
Okay.
For example, what we will do is, here we are learning Java, right? So after the Java, we'll go to Selenium. One second, let me show this. Here, not this, here. Like this project is available, right?
Mm.
Any project. What they will do is all these classes, they will zip it and they will give us. That we call it a jar file in Java.
Okay. Okay.
Like executable file, it is a executable Java file is called a jar file. Okay, they will give this full thing. That means all these classes will come to us in the form of a jar. That jar, we need to add it to our project path. When we start Selenium, I will explain you how to add a jar file to our project path.
Project.
So that all the classes which are part of that jar, that means all these will be considered like available to you, available to your project. Okay. Then what you have to do, you create object of it and then access it. Okay. If that jar is not there inside your class path, then it will not allow you to access it.
Okay. Exactly. Okay. So thanks. So, thanks, Venkat.
Yeah. Similarly, click method and also many methods are there, whatever we are going to use in Selenium, right? So testing, what we do, we click on some element. Further, there is a method click available. We will enter data into some text fields. For that, there is a method called send keys. All these methods are available in some classes. All those classes they wrote inside that they implemented these methods also. Okay. And then they prepared a jar with all those classes to Selenium people. They are giving to us. So what we have to do is we have to add that jar to our project class path, and then we should access those methods. That's it. Okay. So in Java, everything is like a class inside class methods. So many predefined methods are there. That means predefined classes are there for our requirement. Our goal is we should able to understand which method will fit for us and where is it available. That means in which class, create object for it and then use it. Okay. So any other doubts, guys? If no doubts, for today we'll wind up and we'll continue tomorrow. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So, Venkat, who will send the video of today? Because I missed it for 10 minutes.
Yeah, just deep or other deep.
Okay.
You can go.
Yeah, because if they send before end of the day today, we can do a quick one, then it will be good for tomorrow's class.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks again. Thank you all.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
Yeah. You too. Bye.
Good night.
Yeah. Bye.
Venkat, are you in Chennai?
No, in Bangalore.
Oh, okay. Which part in Bangalore?
Hebbal.
Oh, Hebbal, okay.
Manyata Tech Park, do you have idea?
Yeah, I know. I heard it, but I lived in BTM.
Okay, BTM, okay.
Yeah, it was in 2005 to 2007.
Okay, at that time you were in Bangalore.
Yeah, I was in Bangalore.
Okay, Gopi.
Okay, see you then. Okay. Bye. Tomorrow. Yeah.